Hello, and welcome to Automata, Simple Machines Mimicking Life. Today we are going to learn about the origins of modern robotics, couched in art and science of the medieval period and advancements all of the way until today. Among all the things that you'll learn today, you will have the chance to tell people that either A, you saw this amazing program, or B, you saw this terrible program by a guy named Dr. Silas Conundrum with a company called STEMpunkED. STEMpunkED was founded by myself and my two young children because of our love of STEM, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. However, we explored STEM using technology from the 17th century through the early 20th century, anything before the evil laziness of the microchip. Or put another way, we show how STEM was done for the 500 years that came before the last 50 years. So please visit stempunked.com to learn more about what we offer. So, by the time you're done, you will also be able to talk about the origins of automata, from their beginnings in the clock towers of medieval Europe all the way through the machinery that today builds cars and automates the assembly process, as well as cybernetics and robots that are meant to mimic human life. We'll learn about the historical, cultural, and technological importance of automata, because they exist not simply for the drive to do something artistic or replace humans or other forms of life, but there are reasons rooted in the people who researched them and in the societies they lived in and those who chose to build because of what they learned from their societies. We'll also see how automata give rise to the digital era and modern robotics. Automaton is the singular of automata. Automaton is a machine designed to automatically follow a predetermined, meaning already figured out and set, sequence of operations, or respond to predetermined instructions for the purpose of mimicking aspects of life. Even in auto-assembly robots that you see bringing panels into place and welding them, these are activities that were once performed entirely by humans. The robots are mimicking the human motions in the assembly of a car. So automata exist to mimic the operations of life. Their beginning goes all the way back to the medieval times and even starts in a place you would hardly suspect, the countryside. Most people in Europe at this time lived on the countryside. They would never see a city, ever, usually, and they lived by the cycles of nature, not just by the seasons telling them when to plant and when to harvest, but also by the motions of the sun, looking up and knowing exactly what time it was every day, and by the needs of the animals, cows returning from the fields to be milked at specific times of the day as their udders would become full, a rooster crowing to let everyone know that the sun is about to rise. So an order was brought to these people's lives by the environment they lived in, which was nature. But when people began to move to the cities, there was no longer an order of nature to follow. There was chaos. There was disorder. And the people who ruled these cities, the privileged classes, realized that there needed to be a way to control that chaos, to restore a form of order to the operations of the people of the city. And the machine designed to meet that goal of bringing order to chaos was the medieval clock tower. An intensely public structure, one available to all, seen by all, with the sole purpose of standing in the place of nature to establish an order. And of course, in doing so, a clock tower must not only tick away the minutes and sound the hours, but must also replicate the processes of nature to help bring people who came from the countryside to become comfortable and in line with their new environment. Let's take a look at the oldest medieval clock tower, Die Zeitlage, in Bern, Switzerland, built in 1281 CE. That means this clock tower is over 8 centuries old and has been operating constantly since it first began. Let's look at this tower, and please pay special attention not just to the clockwork movements, which are beautiful, but to the elements of this clock tower designed specifically to mimic the processes of life. Certainly a scientific achievement and a work of art. As you paid attention, you probably saw many elements of life being incorporated into the mechanics of this clock tower. The motions of the rooster and its crow, as well as the movements of other animals. The clock was there not just to tell time, but to represent time, and doing so through the motions of life as created by the mechanical operations of the automata included in the clock tower. From these largely public structures for everyone to enjoy and benefit from, the royal class, of course, as always it does, and as always privilege does, wants to have things just for themselves, and much better things. So the automata of the clock gave rise to something smaller, something more intimate, something for the royals only to be distracted and amused by. One such thing was in the Helbrunn Palace, which was a very private structure indeed, only for Europe's most influential and wealthy. Helbrunn Palace was a pleasure palace, lots of great things to do and things to see, in addition to be something of a prankster palace. One of the parts of the palace that demonstrate this is often when lords and ladies would be invited, they would attend a lovely picnic outside on these stone structures where they would sit down to a meal lavish with delicacies and beautiful arrangements of food. And once they had gotten started and had a little bit of this food, the waterworks would be turned on and all of these lords and ladies would discover that suddenly they were in the middle of a water fountain being sprayed from under their bottoms as well as down onto their heads. But beyond the amusing part was this, the Helbrunn Palace Mechanical Theater. This was built in 1750 by a salt miner named Lorenz Rosenegger. He was told by an archbishop who owned the property at the time that he wanted a representation of life and society as it should be. And he gave very specific instructions about how he wanted that done. You should know that all technology has cultural assumptions rooted behind it, ideas about how it should be used and by who. And this technology in particular is going to demonstrate a very rigid view of class structure and who should be doing what and how in society. First, I want you to keep in mind that we are now about to see a demonstration of miniaturization in such an intricate and beautiful level that it simply was mind-blowing at the time, because we moved from something as huge as a clock tower to something not much bigger than a few wardrobes across that could now do so much more than would ever be accomplished in the automata of a clock tower. Please pay special attention to the movements of the people, especially those at the ground level, the workers, the laborers, the people at the middle level, and then at the highest levels. The motions that you see them make and how they look. The frenetic energy of those below is starkly contrasted to the motions of those who were above them. Motions that were barely motions at all, and if they were, they were simply to gratify themselves, such as the woman fanning her face. Here we see automata being implemented not only as representations of life itself, but of the nature and order of life as those around it saw that it should be. If miniaturization was a key and mind-blowing element of the Hellbrunn Theater, you could imagine what it must have been like to see a clock tower shrunk down to something that could fit in one's pocket. The creation of the pocket watch by Peter Henlein in 1524 was the impetus to take this same miniaturization to the next level of creating automata mimicking life. This device by Jacob Frizard, 1785, over two centuries old, does a beautiful job of imitating the motions, the sounds, the appearance of life of a bird. It will be preceded by a smaller demonstration of a cockroach moving. Please, though, when you get to the bird, pay special attention to the motions of the bellows on the left. Bellows are like bags that can be pulled out to bring air in and pushed to push air out, and the clockwork structures around it. And try to determine how they make the motions and the sounds of this bird. And, of course, take a few moments to wonder in its beauty. Imagine someone seeing something like that for the first time. A miniaturization and mechanicalization, if you will, of a life form like this bird. And it certainly looked realistic. The mechanical movements controlling all of the physical representations of the bird and manifestations, and the bellows through a series of pipes creating the whistles and the calls of a bird. People were undertaking this sort of design, artists and scientists alike, for a very specific reason. Lifelike imitations existed not just for their beauty, but rather as the drive to understand the processes of life itself. To the scientists and artists of this time, life itself was simply believed to be a mechanical process that had yet to be fully understood. And part of the process of understanding how anything works is to build models of that thing, to understand its processes. And that is what automata became, so much more than simple works of art, but ways of finding the secrets of life and the ability to create life oneself. This is really demonstrated well by an artist, Jacques Audran, 1768 to 73, created three automata, the artist, the musician, and the writer. Now, the secret to the motions, the lifelike motions behind all of these automata, a mechanical programming language, if you will. You may see yourself in your own future of coding the operations of robots using screens and mouse and drag and drop and keyboards. But long before that existed, there was mechanical coding. Coding the movements using something called the cam and the follower, which are variations on two of the six simple machines, the wheel and axle and the lever. A cam is the wheel part of a wheel and axle that is either offset in some unusual way so it doesn't run perfectly round and flat, or rather has a bump part and a trough part up and down, or has notches and grooves cut through it. A lever called a follower then sits on the cam, and the motions of the cam, either the bumps or grooves or it's being offset to the side, moves the lever in a very specific way. And as the lever attaches to other elements, it controls motion. Let's take a look at a cam and follower in operation. It was invented in 1206 by Ismaili Jazari, who founded the mechanical origins of coding all modern robotics over 8 centuries ago. Pay special attention to the wheel and axle and what follows it, called the follower. The cam and follower were brought to some of their highest achievements in this automaton called the writer by Pierre Jacques Audran, over 2.5 centuries old. The cam and follower is what allowed the magic you are about to see. But first, let me set a mood for you. It's the 1800s. You are at a sumptuous dinner with other lords and ladies. By candlelight, of course, because electric lights have not been invented yet, so all light is dim, soft, and slightly spooky. After your dinner, you're ushered into a dark room. Candlelight flickers and reveals the face of a child sitting at a desk, a face that almost seems lifelike and real. But you're told, no, this is only a machine, but it is a machine imbued with elements of life, like the human mind and the human body. And this will create a letter for you, will write it with his very own hands, using his very own quill. And this is what you would see. Pay special attention to the movements of the discs that you see in the back of the writer. Thank you. cam coded a movement, a letter, a stroke of the pen, a dip of the quill, a movement of the eyes, the shift of the paper, each one guaranteeing very careful accuracy in each letter, in each motion, and guaranteeing a very spooky experience for those watching. But nothing was so mysterious in regards to an automaton at the time as the Turk, a chess-playing automaton. This automaton, over 2.5 centuries ago, was touted as the greatest chess player in all of Europe. And indeed, every chess player brought against the Turk lost the match without fail. Again, imagine the situation where you are being ushered into a plush, dark room. You are shown this figure sitting in front of a chessboard. Have its mechanics revealed to you, a complex set of gears, cams, and followers. And you are told that if you play the Turk, you will lose. And who, of course, wouldn't take that challenge? All of the doors would be closed, and then the game would begin. Let's take a moment and move to this creation called the euphonia. The euphonia was created by Joseph Faber in 1845. Now, we have seen to this point the mechanical implementations of automata, but of course there is also the option for organic and mechanical combinations. Scientists and artists of the time, as I mentioned before, were driven to understand the processes of life. One method of doing this was to simply collect one of the many corpses from the morgues and take them to the workshop and dissect them to follow and learn whatever the body might show you. For some, this meant not only taking apart bodies and studying them, but preserving their various components and reassembling them and trying to make them work again. This device, the euphonia, is the product of just such a design. The face you see on the front of this device is a human face. Its lungs, vocal cords, larynx, all of the components that would have made it sing in real life were reassembled and attached to a mechanical bellows and linked to a keyboard to control its movements, the amount of air, and the lips. And a player would sit at this keyboard and help play the euphonia to sing to its audiences. Which do you find more creepy? The Turk, the euphonia, or the writer? There was also a automata creator, Jacques de Vaucasson, who created the flute player, the tambourine player, and the duck, all of which sadly have been lost to history. No one knows where they are. But taking from the euphonia, the flute player was a preserved female body, tongue, lips, vocal cords, everything, who apparently could play a passable song or two on the flute. I would love to see that. Now we are moving into industrial automata. Pre-industry, before textiles or the creation of machines that would weave thread and turn that thread into cloth, textile production for 12,000 years before what would be called the Industrial Revolution was a long, arduous process of weaving cotton into thread and thread into cloth by hand. This was the loom process early on. You would simply weave one thread back and forth through a set of other threads to create cloth, much like you might do when making a pot holder, for example. This was an example of high technology loom right here, something that you could simply sit up against the side of your house to weave. Became slightly more complex as time went on, building wooden frames that became more and more complex, key of which was something called the shuttle. The shuttle you see here would move back and forth through the lines of cloth to weave a new thread through them perpendicular to the other lines. So you have lines of thread running vertically and a shuttle moving another thread horizontally through the fabric to create cloth. The flying shuttle, again, a massive innovation compared to the handwork we've seen before, but still human scale. One person, one human, weaving the cloth. Just as a matter of comparison for something I want you to see, is the largest textile factory in England before a certain person saw the Turk. This would have been what it would look like inside before a certain person saw the Turk. Several people on these wooden looms weaving as fast as their hearts could drive them. But a man named Cartwright, upon seeing the Turk in action, thought to himself, if we can make a chess-playing automaton, maybe we could make a weaving automaton. And that birthed what was called the Industrial Revolution. Motion of the Turk convinced Cartwright that it was possible to create a machine to weave fabric rather than use people, the very motion of the Turk's arms being the prime innovation. And that changed society. Suddenly, instead of a small factory with a few people working by hand, you would have gigantic rooms of automatic weaving machines able to produce cotton and fabric faster than anyone could do by themselves. And suddenly, what was a simple human-scale, human-driven design that progressed to simple mechanics became massive mechanics, dwarfing the people that would use them. A little cottage industry of just a few in a small area became this, a drawing of one textile mill, one of hundreds across the United Kingdom. A world dominated by agricultural and the countryside gave way to a world of steam-powered production, all driven by machines, not humans. And countrysides changed as smokestacks grew to burn the fuel necessary to heat the water, to make the steam to run these automata, turning blue skies gray, black, and ashen. Before the Industrial Revolution, by the way, the global average of CO2 in the environment was 280 parts per million. So before we decided to make automata that could make cloth faster than humans ever possibly could, 280 parts per million CO2. The global average of CO2 in 2018, 407.4 parts per million, nearly double since we began using machines to replace humans. And carbon dioxide levels are higher than any point in at least the past 800,000 years. Which now brings us back to the Turk, who inspired Cartwright. Well, guess what? The Turk traveled Europe for 84 years beating chess players, but the Turk had a secret that was not discovered during any of those 84 years. The Turk was a fraud. Inside the machine, behind the gear work, was a human, a master chess player, who would simply look at the reflection of the board above and match movements on the board contained below within the cabinetry. So the Turk was fake. But I leave you with this thought on that topic. The Turk was fake. It was not real. But the fiction of the Turk, the idea of the Turk, inspired Cartwright to create the Industrial Revolution that changed the entire world. Interesting what only an idea can accomplish. The future implications of automata. The inorganic meets the organic, in certain ways similar to what we saw with the combining of organics and machines in the euphonia. First of all, the Turk did make a return because the very idea of a machine that could beat a human at chess inspired the imaginations of early computer developers and automata developers. And it finally did begin to happen in the computing world with a program called Mac Hack 6 in 1966 when they tried to create a computer program that could beat a chess master at chess. Though it didn't actually work until 1997 when IBM's Deep Blue versus human chess player Garry Kasparov, the first time a computer, a machine if you will, was able to beat a human. This leads us to the very next steps in the evolution of automata, a progression from early times with clock towers to modern times in factories and in innovative hubs that are trying to find ways to not just replace human movements, but to replace, mimic, and improve upon human thought, human feeling, human expression. Let's take a look at automata throughout time.
Let's take a look.
Can you say Skynet? So, any questions you have, I would love to hear in just a few moments. But before we do, I would like to let you know that in person, when I deliver this program, I then move on to an entire section on simple machines, and we discuss the six simple machines and how in combinations they can be used to create automata models, simple or complex, that mimic the structures of life. I have a section of my garage devoted entirely to storing beautiful automata models, all handmade, that I bring to my locations where I deliver these programs in person. And after doing this presentation and learning about simple machines, then we begin actually dissecting them in our own way visually to see how each of their movements are created using the six simple machines and those motions and how they are coded using the cam and the follower and the lever and the wheel looking underneath, because all of the mechanics of these automata are completely exposed for people to see. I believe that ends the time I have now. Thank you so very much for taking the time to attend. Do please remember the website, stempunked.com. We have 16 amazing programs, much like this one, with eye-opening presentations and wonderful hands-on opportunities with vintage tech for the last 500 years. Thank you so much, and have a good day.